On March 19, 2003, the U.S. and its allies went to war against the Iraqi strongman Saddam Hussein. A few months of media campaign was enough to make Iraq an imminent threat to peace and security. Now the war was inevitable, and saving the world from Iraq's weapons of mass destruction was a burden upon the shoulders of the U.S. Army and its allies. No stone was left unturned, but no WMDs were found. The main reason for the U.S.-led invasion of Iraq turned to be just a figment of imagination.
It turns out we were all wrong, probably, in my judgment. And that is most disturbing.
Throughout the summer and fall of 2004, the U.S. military conducted two major assaults, which flattened the Iraqi city of Fallujah and displaced most of the city's 300,000 population. In the assault, U.S. commanders largely treated Fallujah as a free fire zone to try to reduce casualties among their own troops. British officers were appalled by the lack of concern for civilian casualties. The U.S. commander who ordered this devastating use of firepower did not consider it significant enough to mention it in his daily report to the U.S. general in command.
Was the American crusade against Iraq a war crime? The answer was yes to many political experts and international lawyers. One of the most vocal opponents of the Iraq war is Professor Noam Chomsky. According to the New York Times, Noam Chomsky is arguably the most important intellectual alive. We now sit for an interview with Professor Chomsky on the topic of war crimes.
Professor Chomsky, thanks so much for joining us. I guess my first question is, how does international criminal law define the concept of war crime?
Well, a major contribution to this was the Nuremberg Tribunal, which was later incorporated into international law, and it defines aggression as the supreme international crime, war crime. Different from other war crimes, in that it includes all of the evil that follows. So to apply it to a recent case, the U.S.-British supreme crime of invading Iraq includes within it guilt for the conflicts that followed, the destruction of the Mosque at Samarra, the Sunni-Shiite conflicts, all the terror, everything that followed.
Dramatic increases in infant mortality, cancer, and leukemia in the Iraqi city of Fallujah, which was bombarded by U.S. Marines in 2004, exceed those reported by survivors of the atomic bombs that were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki in 1945, according to a new study. It's been estimated that about 1.5 million Iraqis have died due to U.S. invasion since 2003.
How significant were the Nuremberg trials in establishing the principles of international law regarding war, genocide, and so forth?
They were significant. It's good that it took place, but we should remember that they were deeply flawed. The Nuremberg principles are, you know, laudable, but the practice was pretty awful. So, for example, the practice defined war crime as a crime that the Nazis committed and we didn't commit, crucially. So Nazi defendants were able to plead in defense that the U.S. and Britain had carried out the same crimes, and that was accepted. They were then released on that. So Admiral Dönitz, a submarine commander, he brought in testimony, one of the top figures in the British Admiralty, and an American Admiral Nimitz, who testified that, yes, we committed the same crimes. So therefore, he wasn't guilty of those crimes. Heavy bombing of urban concentrations, which is a major crime. that was excluded altogether because the Allies did more than the Germans. And it sort of continues like that. So, you know, the general principles are deserve respect, but the practice deserves contempt.
According to one of the Nuremberg principles, principle 4, war crime is defined as, quote, planning, preparation, initiation, or waging of a war of aggression or a war in violation of international treaties, agreements, or assurances. So I guess my question is, based on this definition, could the U.S. and U.K.-led war against Iraq in 2003 be considered an instance of a war crime?
It's almost a paradigm example. It's also, incidentally, related to the current issues over Iran in an interesting way, which is never discussed. The U.S. and Britain tried to provide a kind of a thin legal cover for the invasion. The legal cover was, as you know, that Saddam had not ended his programs of weapons of mass destruction. The legal basis was that they appealed to a Security Council resolution, 687, 1991, which called upon Saddam to terminate programs of weapons of mass destruction. And the legal basis for the invasion was, well, he hadn't done it. Of course, he had done it, but then that was later discovered.
What you will see is an accumulation of facts and disturbing patterns of behavior. The facts and Iraq's behavior demonstrate that Saddam Hussein and his regime have made no effort to disarm as required by the international community.
The interesting part of this, if you read that resolution, Article 14, it commits the signers to work for a nuclear weapons-free zone in the region. U.S. and Britain are obligated to do that uniquely because of the background that I mentioned. It has almost universal international support, just about everybody. At the recent non-aligned meeting in Tehran, it was again strongly supported.
من تأكيد میکنم که جمهوری اسلامی هرگز در پی تسلیحات هسته‌ای نیست و نیز هرگز از حق ملت خود در استفاده صلح‌آمیز از انرژی هسته‌ای چشم پوشی نخواهد کرد. شعار ما انرژی هسته‌ای برای همه و سلاح هسته‌ای برای هیچ کس است. ما بر این هر دو سخن پای خواهیم فشرد و می‌دانیم که شکستن انحصار چند کشور غربی در تولید انرژی هسته‌ای در چهارچوب معاهده عدم اشاعه به سود همه کشورهای مستقل و از جمله کشورهای عضو جنبش عدم تعهد است.
Egypt for almost 20 years has been leading the non-aligned movement and trying to move towards doing this, and it has almost total support. And there's a meeting coming up, conference in Helsinki in the next couple of months to try to move this forward. Well, it's not going to get anywhere for a simple reason. The U.S. is against it. The U.S. has been blocking it for many years. And Obama's current position is a fine idea, but not now, and Israel has to be excluded, which is forget it, you know. Israel's already indicated they're probably not going to attend the conference.
Israel is widely believed to be the first and only country in the Middle East to possess nuclear weapons. Israel has refused to sign the NPT despite international pressure to do so, and has stated that signing the treaty would be contrary to its national security interests. It is estimated that Israel has 75 to 200 nuclear warheads.
Amid all the talk of Iran is aiming to equip itself with nuclear weapons, it seems too often ignored that the one Middle East country that indisputably has nuclear weapon is Israel. Shortly before stepping down as the IAEA Director General in November 2009, Mohammad al-Baradei declared, "This is not really sustainable that you have Israel sitting with nuclear weapons capability there, while everyone else is part of the non-proliferation regime."
The person who in 1986 produced the conclusive evidence for Israel having these weapons was Mordechai Vanunu. For this, he has suffered 26 years loss of freedom, including 18 years in prison.
Israel don't need the nuclear arms, especially now that all the Middle East is free from nuclear weapons. Iraq don't have a nuclear weapon. Libya, Iran, Egypt, all the Middle East is free from nuclear weapons. Only Israel still have secrets.
If you look at the what's called the free press, it's quite interesting. There is not a single word about this. There's not even a single word about the upcoming conference, which is the obvious way to deal with whatever threat you want. That's pretty impressive. I don't think you could achieve that in a totalitarian state. And it's not under government pressure. Government can't. It's not a conspiracy. It's just internalized in the educated classes that you don't expose the crimes of state. It's so deeply internalized that they can't even think of doing it. There literally isn't a word.
And how much power does the prosecutor at the International Criminal Court have at the end of the day?
Well, it's kind of like the United Nations. Technically, there's power, but in reality, they can do exactly what the major powers, mainly the U.S., allow them to do, and nothing more. It's true of the United Nations, it's true of the International Court of Justice, through the International Criminal Court. So they're bounded by what the great powers, meaning the U.S. primarily, will allow. And if you look at the cases they've taken, you can see it. They only take cases that the U.S. wants to be prosecuted.
So theoretically speaking, could the ICC actually issue warrants of arrest for George W. Bush and Tony Blair?
Well, there is legislation in the United States, as you may know, passed by Congress, signed by President Bush, which in Europe is called the Netherlands Invasion Act. The legislation authorizes the United States to use force to rescue any American who's brought to The Hague. Okay. The United States is the only country in the world that has rejected an International Court of Justice condemnation. It ordered the United States back in 1985 to 86 to terminate the terrorist attack against Nicaragua and pay huge reparations. The U.S. reacted by Congress expanding the funding for the attacks. The court was dismissed. So, for example, right now, as you know, the Palestinian Authority is appealing to the General Assembly to upgrade the status of the Palestinians at the United Nations. And the U.S. is strongly opposed. Israel, of course, opposed. Most of the world supports it.
Voting has been completed. Please lock the machine.
My position has been consistent all along. I believe that the Palestinians have a legitimate right to their own independent state.
Today's unfortunate and counterproductive resolution places further obstacles in the path to peace. That is why the United States voted against it.
The primary reason is that if the Palestinian Authority were upgraded, it would theoretically have the option of bringing war crimes cases against Israel to the International Criminal Court. Of course, the U.S. would never allow this to proceed, but they don't want to be in a position where they have to publicly bar prosecution of criminal cases. So they're trying very hard to prevent it from happening. All kind of punishments of the Palestinians threatened and so on. And this is one of the main reasons.
Right. Why was the ICC set up in the first place?
The whole international legal apparatus was established in stages after the Second World War. Second World War was pretty much a shock. Some pretty awful things happened. There was a lot of pressure for making sure that things like that don't happen again. You read the Charter of the United Nations, it opens by saying, we want to free the world from the scourge of war, which has just been so hideous and so on. And out of that came revitalization or innovation, partly revitalization of structures that were there under the League of Nations, but had never done anything. So you get the International Court of Justice, later the International Criminal Court, and so on, and the Geneva Convention, the 1949 Geneva Convention, so later Geneva Protocol. And over the years, there's just been expansion of the pressure to develop a system of international law. The definition of aggression you read is there, but it was later extended and accepted by the General Assembly unanimously and so on. The reason is, and this of course goes way back, in 1928 there was a treaty, Kellogg-Briand Treaty, to try to outlaw war. It was a reflection of the horrors of the First World War. You go back earlier, you get the Hague Conventions a century ago and so on. So there's been a long effort over the century, in fact going back to the late 19th century, to do something about the incredibly destructive character of modern war. This general understanding among people with gray cells functioning, we have to do something about this. And out of this came the set of principles. Unfortunately, the set of principles, however nice they are on paper, cannot be implemented unless the major power systems permit it.
And how important was the principle of, quote, starting a war of aggression, as we talked about earlier, or crime against peace in the proceedings at Nuremberg that led to the hanging of many leading Nazis? Can the International Criminal Court prosecute these crimes?
Yes, it was a major factor in the hanging of Nazi war criminals. In fact, if you look closely, it's even more pertinent to the present. So von Ribbentrop, the foreign minister, one of the charges against him was that he supported a preemptive war against Norway. The Nazis knew that the British were thinking of invading from Norway, so they preempted it and established the Quisling government there. That was one of the crimes against von Ribbentrop. How about Colin Powell? He justified a preemptive war against no threat. So if von Ribbentrop was hanged, you know, okay, you can fill it out. So could the International Criminal Court do something like that? Only if it wanted to be immediately destroyed.
You know, the architecture of international law since World War II, apart from Article 51 of the United Nations Charter, the right to self-defense, requires the Security Council to legitimize political violence and criminal action. Is there any possibility that international law will one day challenge the supremacy of the Security Council?
Well, of course, in a certain sense it has. I mean, for one thing, the great powers don't pay any attention to it. So, for example, you look at Article 2 of the UN Charter. It bans the threat or use of force in international affairs. Every time President Obama or any other Western leader opens his mouth, he's issuing a threat of force against Iran. That's what it means to say all options are open. And it's not an idle threat. You take a look at the armaments in the area and so on. It's a very live threat. And nobody says a word.
No options off the table means I'm considering all options. I will take no options off the table. And I mean what I say.
All options remain on the table to prevent Iran from acquiring a nuclear weapon.
I wrote an article criticizing the assassination of Osama bin Laden. You know, going back to the 13th century, there's a fundamental principle that people are Magna Carta, that people are innocent until proved guilty. And if a charge has to be brought to a fair and speedy trial and so on, well, obviously everything is violated. There was a lot of anger about that. There was one interesting response from a kind of a well-known left liberal young political analyst, Matthew Iglesias. He said this is extremely naive because the whole purpose of international law is to legitimate the use of force by the Western powers, meaning the United States. Well, yeah, he's not wrong. It's nice to have somebody say the words. But what he's saying is, look, forget all the rhetoric. This is pure farce. We're just like the Nazis. We do what we like.
And is there any fundamental problem that war crimes, rather like terrorism, is never defined properly?
No, that's not true. Terrorism is defined very properly. I've been writing about terrorism since 1981, since Ronald Reagan came into office and declared that a war on terror would be the centerpiece of American policy. I'd written about it before, but after that, there's a huge amount of literature on terrorism, and I wrote about it too. But what I wrote is excluded from the canon for a very simple reason. I took the official definitions of terrorism, which are pretty good. I took the definition that's given in U.S. and British law, which is a fine definition, but has a flaw. If you apply it, it turns out the United States is one of the leading terrorist states in the world. And since you can't have that conclusion, you have to find a new definition. And for the last 30 years, there have been extensive efforts to find a definition of terrorism. There's academic conferences, scholarly works and so on, and they're all based on what you just said. There's no good definition. Actually, there's no good definition that defines terrorism so that it includes what they do to us but doesn't include what we do to them, which is usually much worse. And it is hard to get a definition with that property, but the definitions are fine. They're in the U.S. Code, in British law, they're endorsed by UN resolutions and so on. It's just that they're inapplicable, because if you apply them, you get the consequence I described.
Is there any point in international law when countries like the United States, Israel, and the UK can just ignore it?
It could change if popular movements within the powerful states compel the governments to stop being rogue states.
The American people don't know that to attack a country that has done you no harm is a war crime. And even threatening Iran by Israel and the U.S. all the time is a violation of international law.
By now, the world is considerably more diverse. The U.S. is still by far the most powerful state, but it can still pronounce the principles of 1945, but it's much harder to implement them, and often it can't. U.S. power has diminished increasingly in recent years. You could run through it, but it really starts in the late 40s. So one thing that can change is the international system. Another and major factor has to be internal to the aggressive states. With regard to Israel, it's a different issue. Israel can do just as much as the U.S. allows it to do. So if the U.S. were to withdraw participation in Israel's crimes, it would have to stop.
Why does the United States avoid to be involved in the ICC?
For the same reason that it rejects the World Court jurisdiction. As I said, it's the only country to have rejected an International Court of Justice decision. it is above the law. It wants to be able to act freely. In fact, why is the U.S. so hostile to Iran? It's kind of interesting to look. I mean, we have an authoritative answer. It comes from the Pentagon and U.S. intelligence. They say Iran could be a deterrent to the United States. And the U.S. cannot tolerate a deterrent. If you want to use force freely, and you feel you have a right to, a deterrent can't be tolerated.
Professor Chomsky, thanks so much for joining us.